Order. It's time for questions to the Minister of Employment and Learning, and we will start with listed questions. And I call Mr. Stephen Agnew. Mr. Agnew.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Question number one, please.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. The First Minister and Deputy First Minister announced in July 2012 that they wished to wait the outcome of engagement with party leaders on the number of government departments before making any decision on the future of Dell. This matter is on the agenda of the ongoing all-party talks. I believe the number of departments should be rationalised from 12 to 8 from the start of the next mandate of the Assembly. However, any reallocation of functions should be based around the creation of what are essentially new departments rather than existing departments subsuming new functions into existing organisational structures and corporate plans. My department may have been created as an amalgamation of functions from different departments. However, today it is a coherent organisation based around a unified agenda of promoting and addressing the skill needs of the people of Northern Ireland and helping them to find and to sustain employment. Much of the current synergy within Dell would be lost in the event that its functions were dispersed. Indeed, there would be a very real danger that the executive's ability to grow and transform the economy at a time of critical importance would be substantially damaged. For these reasons, I consider that virtually all of the functions of the department should remain together, either within a single department or as part of a wider department of the economy. While there may be a superficially attractive option to have a single department addressing education from nursery through to higher education, the more compelling requirement is to ensure that further education and higher education are directly meeting the needs of the economy. The present interface between Dell and DE is managed today and can continue to be managed under any future arrangements.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer. And it does seem to be yet another example where OFM-DFM promises what it can't in fact deliver. The Minister made reference to the talks and proposals to have a perhaps more strategic approach to reducing the number of departments. Can he outline any lessons that have been learned in this process where his department's been looked at to make sure that if we do make that the strategic decision, we can actually deliver on it?
Well, I wouldn't agree with the member. This is something that has been forgotten by OFM, DFM. They've taken the correct decision to actually view it as part of a wider consideration of departments, and that process is very much alive today. And the members will be aware that that is an item that has been actively discussed within the current round of talks, and that there may well indeed be a positive outcome in that regard. I think what we want to avoid is a situation where departments are carved up for political ends, which was the danger in 2012. Rather, today we have the opportunity to do this as part of a wider reform of government structures, which is more about servicing the people of Northern Ireland and the businesses of Northern Ireland in as efficient and effective way as possible. We can certainly learn lessons from the discussions that happened in 2012, where I think right across the stakeholders, whether we're talking universities, colleges, the business organisations and students themselves, they all saw the benefit of a single department of the economy rather than my department being split between two different departments. We can also look to our experiences elsewhere in these islands, where, for example, universities are part of a business department in the London setting, which does give them a certain degree of profile. Whereas, by contrast, they are part of a wider Department of Education in the Republic of Ireland, and frankly, they tend to get lost in discussions around primary and secondary education in that jurisdiction.
Here, I call Mr. Alistair Ross.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I tend to agree with the Minister that what we ultimately want to see is a Department for the Economy, which would include some of the powers that his department currently has. Can the Minister explain to the House the benefits of seeing colleges and universities as economic drivers, and how a Department for the Economy would help in terms of the work that not only Invest Northern Ireland are doing in attracting companies to come and invest in Northern Ireland, but also in terms of training young people in economically relevant areas?
Well, I tend to concur with the member, and just to be clear, I would see virtually all of my department going in to a Department of the Economy alongside virtually all of DETI, and indeed there may well be other functions across government departments that could be consolidated in such a manner. It is very clear that both the further education sector and universities are a key part of our economic narrative in Northern Ireland. You just look, for example, to what Invest Northern Ireland are doing in terms of how they're reaching out to companies overseas. and universities are central to that narrative. Our colleges have come on leaps and bounds in the past decade in terms of their relevance to the economy. Right at the tip of the spear, they're offering programmes through our Assured Skills scheme, whereby they will actually provide the very ready-made employees that companies require, and we've been able to attract companies to Northern Ireland based upon that very innovative approach that's not available in other competing jurisdictions for what is often mobile international investments. Also, the curriculum within both our colleges and universities is very heavily determined by the needs of the economy. Frankly, this is why we are investing public money in the colleges and universities, to ensure that they are providing the skilled workers of the future to meet the demands of the economy. And we know that we will need more and more higher-level skills over the years to come, and our colleges and universities are the key delivery partner in that regard.
Ian Commissioner Tom Elliott.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for that. Given that the Minister has indicated his department is supportive of a single department for the economy, what areas is he suggesting within his current department will go to other departments, and what other departments would they be?
Well, I should hesitate that the views that I'm expressing are my own personal views on the matter, and also the views of my political party. I wouldn't speak on behalf of the individual members of staff within the department. But it is interesting to note that whenever the Employment and Learning Committee did an exercise in this regard in the spring of 2012, the views that were coming across very strongly from the employees within the department were that they saw themselves as being part of a single department of the economy. They understood the relevance of what they were doing of being of economic relevance. That's why they were motivated to fulfil the service functions that we are asking of them. And again, just to reiterate in terms of Mr. Elliott's specific question, I would envisage virtually all of the functions of my department being part of a single department of the economy. My department is a coherent, unified department based around skills and employability. All of the different divisions are pushing in the one direction in that regard. So I believe they should be transferred en bloc into the new architecture, and I believe that view is supported by virtually all the stakeholders in wider society.
Sir Oliver McMullen is not in his place, so I call Mr. Roy Beggs.
Question number 3.
Considering the scale of budget cuts facing my department of 10.8%, there will undoubtedly be a detrimental impact on further education colleges, including their provision of frontline services. Officials from my department are working with the colleges to consider different options for reducing spend. This will require making difficult decisions over the coming weeks. The colleges have been advised that in the event that they are faced with cuts of 10.8%, this will mean 500 fewer staff and 16,000 fewer student enrolments. I can assure the Assembly that my department will strive to mitigate against the worst impact of these cuts. However, it is clear that even core frontline services will be affected.
And call Mr. Beggs for a supplement.
As the Executive and indeed this Assembly debates the budget and tries to ensure there is an adequate amount of funding provided to further education, will the Minister assure me and my constituents that constituencies such as East Antrim, where there is not an effective centre of further education, will not be further marginalised, and that there will be adequate outreach into local communities, and not as at present, where the Northern Regional College recognises that parts of Carrickfergus, Larne and indeed Moyle are not adequately provided for FE opportunities?
Well, I can give the member the assurance in this sense that we're not planning any major revisions of the FE estate outside what is currently envisaged in terms of the weighted business case for redevelopment in the Northern Regional College area. But we're not expecting any major changes in terms of the southern part of its jurisdictional area. In terms of community outreach, I do have a very strong commitment that we will seek to ensure that we are providing skills, including to those who are most vulnerable in our society. But at this stage, it's very difficult to give any guarantees, because we're still bottoming out with the colleges how they're going to approach this. And until we get an indication of a more favourable financial settlement, it's very difficult to give any assurance that any particular service area will be entirely immune from cuts. But I'm not taking an Islamicising approach to what the further education sector is doing, and we will approach this in a considered strategic manner with a view to what's most important for the economy and how we ensure we actually continue to engage with those who are most marginalised from the economy.
Mr. Sean Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. President, Deputy Speaker. Minister, many young people at 16 decide to further their education in their local further education college rather than staying on in the school. How will you ensure that they are not negatively impacted upon them as opposed to if they had stayed in school?
Well, it's probably the similar answer to I gave to Mr. Beggs a few minutes ago, that we will be as strategic as we can in terms of the approach that we are taking. And the member will be aware that some acknowledgement was given in terms of the draft budget to the role of further education and indeed my department in a wider sense through training organisations for 16 to 19-year-olds. But bluntly, if we have a situation where there is disproportionate protection given to the Department of Education over the situation in terms of further education and training, there will be a major inequity in terms of our support. And put it very bluntly, we will end up where predominantly middle-class children who are availing of a grammar school education will get a greater degree of protection than those who are in the further education and training sector. And the demographics in that regard are sometimes different from what we would see in terms of those who are staying on in education at the secondary level.
Anna Comas, Anna Lowe.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Certainly, the proposed cuts to the Minister's department are really severe. Can I ask the Minister if he needs to make cuts in the further education sector, what difficulties will he face?
Well, I think it's worth referencing that the further education sector has been run on a very efficient basis over the past number of years. There hasn't actually been an increase in funding for further education in real terms since 2007. So they have been surviving on an ever-decreasing budget in terms of the actual spend related to that. And that means that they've always been pushing efficiencies over the past number of years. The sector themselves have also been consolidated to a great extent, and the fact that we're now down to six colleges across Northern Ireland from what was previously a situation where we'd well into the teens, and before that was well into the 20s in the numbers of different colleges across Northern Ireland. So there already has been a considerable consolidation within the FE sector. Now, that doesn't preclude us doing more in that regard, and one of the areas we are looking at is whether there's scope for a shared service delivery across the sector, and I'm pleased that all of the colleges are very much up for looking at solutions in that regard. But I do need to make clear that it's very difficult to see where the FE sector can actually make savings that are genuine efficiencies as opposed to what are very sadly going to be cuts in terms of provision.
Yeah, and Commissioner Robin Newton.
Number four, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker.
The Belfast Metropolitan College is currently preparing a comprehensive estate strategy for all of its campuses. Following significant recent investment in new facilities in Titanic Water and Springvale, the college is considering its needs for the remainder of its estate infrastructure. Included in this is a strategic outline case for the redevelopment of the Castlereagh campus on Montgomery Road, which will consider, at a high level, the accommodation required to meet the current and future curriculum and business demands for the area. The college has advised that a strategic outline case will be submitted to my department in the new year.
Newton for a supplementary.
Thank the Minister for his answer so far. Can I ask the Minister, in terms of the new year, would the Minister be prepared to think about the development of the site in a three-phased strategy? A, that the vocational units which are proposed to be on the site would be taken as one phase, that the potential of Belfast City Council providing a leisure centre on the site would be taken as a second phase, and indeed that the college in itself may be taken as a third phase, and not in any particular order, I might add, but indeed that might allow, under a constrained financial situation, for something to actually happen on the site.
Well, I'm very much open to what the member says, and we're happy to look at how we can develop our estate in as creative a manner as we possibly can. What I would say, however, is that without that degree of creativity, particularly in terms of how we can generate additional capital. It's unlikely that we're going to be able to progress this in the short-term future or indeed medium-term future, because there's actually quite a lot of works in the pipeline in relation to further education. The member will know that there's been a number of schemes approved in relation to the southern region, and we're also waiting decisions in terms of the northern regional college area. And both of those areas have had an underinvestment relative to the other four college areas in terms of recent years. So whether it's in terms of the economics or the justice of the situation, those two areas do need to be given priority in terms of new capital funding. There's also proposals in relation to a new shared facility in terms of the old Durham Hospital site in Enniskillen for South West College. But within that context, we are willing to receive the case from BMC, and if there's a different way of slicing this up, then that may make the situation somewhat easier. All I can say is the colleges, the quicker that business cases are received, the quicker we can process them, and as and when capital funds become available, we can make the bids to draw that money down.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Alec Maskey.
Cashier Rakug in Lindahall. Question number one.
My department has been developing the 2014-20 European Social Fund programme and consulted on its proposed content in the summer of 2013. The draft operational programme was submitted to the European Commission for approval in July 2014. Since then, the public expenditure climate has worsened considerably. The draft budget for 2015-16 provides for a net 10.8% cash reduction to the department's baseline of £756 million, which equates to a cut of £82 million. On top of this, £35 million of funding, in addition to the baseline which my department spends largely on the provision for young people, comes to an end at the end of this current financial year. The total ESF allocation for the period 2014-20 is approximately £165 million. As part of developing the programme, I have ensured that young people not in educational employment or training, aged between 16 to 24, are a key priority group for support within the fund. Approximately £20 million of the European Social Fund budget will be made available to support young people within this age bracket. It is hoped that 25,000 NEET participants will avail of training. In addition, around another £8 million of European Social Fund funding is being directed to finance the Community Family Support Programme, which targets young people and their families. It is expected that 12,600 NEET participants aged 16 and over will be supported under this programme. It should be noted that to enable the department to fully avail of this European funding, a departmental contribution of 25%, some £17 million, must be secured, with an additional 35%, £24 million, of match funding be required from other public or private sources.
Ask you for a supplementary.
Could I thank the Minister for that response, and I do appreciate the budgetary problems that the Minister, as others in executive, do face at this moment in time. Could the Minister elaborate at all? Is he in any way positioned to able to engage further with the EU Commission to try to look at other ways of maximising the drawdown of funds for such programmes?
Well, I think the first thing to say is that we are privileged in Northern Ireland through our membership of the European Union, along with that be the case, that we have access to the European Social Fund, because it allows us to access resources that would simply not be available through our domestic budget. So in that regard, this is something that is a huge opportunity for us. We have actually received a larger European Social Fund pot for the forthcoming period than the outgoing period, so already we have an improved situation. That said, there are more pressures on the European Social Fund, given the cuts in funding that are coming to us. I think rather than getting a different ESF allocation, I think where more productive discussions would be if there are any particular new funds that are produced by the European Commission over the coming months, as to whether Northern Ireland can make applications in that regard. And certainly I'm more than up for doing that, and I know the MEPs will be very eager to try to scope out such opportunities directly in Brussels, as will the Northern Ireland office in Brussels as well. So that's something that we will certainly keep an open mind on.
Mr. Robin Swan.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I thank the Minister for his answers to date. Minister, I recently met with Start 360 and Bernardo's NI in Ballymena, who were originally or are currently funded under SIF. Now, they've been redirected to apply for ESF funding, which is going to be complicated and a change of direction for them. Can the Minister advise what advice his department officials are given to those voluntary community organisations who are being redirected to ESF for the first time? And also, would he undertake maybe to visit the work of 360 and Bernardo's and Ballymena just to see the work they are doing?
Just in terms of the latter point, one needs to be slightly careful in terms of any direct engagement with organisations, given that we are part of a competitive process in terms of the allocation of those funds, and it's important that that process is seen to be open and transparent. Our members of our ESF team have been engaged in a series of roadshows across Northern Ireland to provide information to anyone who's interested, and we have been pleased with the degree of engagement that we've had in that regard. Indeed, it's been an event in each of the new 11 district councils, and that's the best way to get the information across in a fair and open manner as to the nature of the process. Certainly, I wish all the organisations well in that regard. Just want to assure them that we will give every bid that we receive due consideration, and that we will see how far the money can go in terms of meeting the different projects that come forward. But I stress we're in a competitive process with a fixed amount of money, and members need to be aware that we won't be able to support everything in due course.
Councillor Gregory Campbell.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. When deploying the resources from the ESF, can the Minister ensure that young people that are not only not in education or training, that live in hard-to-reach areas, are particularly targeted because they appear to have, by and large, been missed by many of the schemes in the past?
Yes, I mean, the member makes a useful point in that regard, and at times whenever you have a process where bids are coming in a competitive basis, that the resulting distribution of funds can more be a reflection of the capacity of the organisations to make bids as opposed to what the need is on the ground. And that's why we have gone for a much more strategic approach in terms of trying to identify need at a grassroots level to ensure that there's a better coverage in that regard. Also, it's important as well to stress that in terms of those young people who are most vulnerable, it's not simply those who are in the need category that the fund will be of relevance to. We'll be able to support those young people with disabilities. There's a particular focus that the fund will have in relation to level one attainment, which will be the trigger point for accessing some of our mainstream level two programmes. For example, the forthcoming new system of youth training, which I believe will revolutionise what we're doing in terms of training for those who are leaving school at 16. And in addition, the European Social Fund can also support what we're doing in terms of that scheme, and also what we're doing in terms of apprenticeships.
I'm going to call Mr. Sydney Anderson.
Question 6, Principal Deputy Speaker.
Northern Ireland's higher education providers play a vital role in meeting the skill needs of the local economy, not only by providing a supply of highly skilled graduates, but also through reskilling and upskilling the existing workforce. The Northern Ireland Skills Strategy identifies the skills issues that need to be addressed in order to reduce the productivity gap between Northern Ireland and the rest of the UK by 2020. The strategy recognises the need for upskilling the current workforce, and to achieving a higher proportion of individuals in the workforce with higher level skills in the region of 80% by the year 2020. Our approach has been commended by the OECD following worldwide research that it has carried out. It regards the current education and training system in Northern Ireland as having some of the best international practice and aspects which are world class. Skills are the foundation for delivering improved productivity and growth. They provide the platform for successful innovation, export-led growth, and are the most important factor for attracting inward investment to Northern Ireland. The need to develop the Northern Ireland skills base further, particularly for those with higher level skills by our higher education sector, is recognised within the Executive's Programme for Government and also supporting strategies. The role of universities is of critical importance in driving sustainable economic prosperity through high-quality, international, excellent research, and translating that research into successful innovation through knowledge transfer. All central planks of both the Northern Ireland Economic Strategy and the Executive's recently published Innovation Strategy. Indeed, a university income from business and community engagement is now reaching some £92 million, for example, in the year 2012-13. Recent job announcements, including those by City, are concrete examples of how high-level skills can drive our economy forward. The level of cuts proposed from my department will have a very significant and unavoidable impact on our higher education institutions, effectively affecting their capacity to provide the high-level skills and qualifications necessary to grow our economy.
I call Mr. Anderson for a supplementary.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for that response. But does the Minister accept that if places are cut in our universities, that it will make it even more difficult for InvestNI to attract high-quality jobs here in Northern Ireland?
Absolutely, and that is why I am, amongst other reasons, concerned about the impact of cuts upon my departmental's budget. Between our universities and colleges, some 70% of my budget is allocated in that direction. So our ability to absorb 10.8% cuts as a department without touching the front line in terms of our universities and colleges is extremely difficult. I am determined to work with the institutions to see how far we can go to mitigate the impact of the cuts in terms of the front line, and there may well be things we can do in that regard. But ultimately, what we need is a more responsible approach across the board in terms of how we set the budget in Northern Ireland. We have to understand that our universities are an investment in the future. This is not money that we're wasting. This is an investment in the future of our economy and also the future of our young people. So we do need to have a fundamental reassessment of where we're going in that regard. One thing that I am loath to do is that we simply stretch our budgets ever further and dilute the quality of what's currently offered in our universities. That's not going to be in anyone's interest. And it is worth noting that already, depending upon which funding band you're talking about, there's a funding gap of between £1,000 and £2,500 per place. Relative between Northern Ireland and Great Britain. That's an existing structural problem that we have going forward, which the current budget is only compounding ever further. So there are major decisions that we will have to take over the coming weeks, both at executive level and also in my department, as to how we can try to mitigate this, because if we are seeing a cut in the scale of our universities and also our colleges, that will send out a very negative message to the rest of the world, as well as a negative message to our young people locally.
Sir Phil Flanagan.
I thank the Minister for his answer. He'll be aware that a rally organised by FE and HE students is due to take place tomorrow against the cuts to FE and HE colleges and universities. Does the Minister accept that we all need to work together to present a united approach to the British Government and send them a very clear message that the cuts they're trying to impose on the block grant is seriously damaging the Executive's ability to deliver core frontline services?
Well, I think there's some work to be done in terms of parties making a common approach to Westminster in terms of seeing what specific funding packages that we can secure. But if we're talking about trying to wipe the slate clean and forgetting about things like welfare reform, I don't think that's a realistic strategy for us. I think the pathway before us in that regard is very clear. And I would say to the member, if he is concerned about the cuts that are looming in terms of further education and higher education, he and his party colleagues have it within their power, not the British Government's power, within their power to make difficult but responsible decisions about putting the funding of the Northern Ireland budget back on a sustainable footing, and that way beginning to address the problems that are facing across a whole range of departments.
I call Ms Kieran McEvitt.
Thank you, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, I know in his previous answer he talked about the front line and how important that was. If things don't work out with this current budget, can he give us a projected job losses expected in the higher or further education as a result of this?
Well, again, based upon the projections in terms of the level of cuts that are facing, we are talking about several hundred job losses within the higher education sector, and that is a very serious state of play facing people's individual lives as well as the universities themselves. But again, I'm concerned when the member says if things don't work out in terms of the budget, in case we're sitting here, sitting back in this assembly, waiting for something to drop from the sky, that's beyond our control. And I would stress to the member as well, her party has a major role to play in terms of acting more responsibly around budgets as well. If we're prepared to take difficult decisions, whether it's around revenue raising, whether it's actually recognised that we have to face up to the fact that welfare reform is an inescapable pressure, no one wants to go down that route, but it is a reality that we are facing as a devolved region, then the solutions lie in our hands. So it's not a case of us sitting back waiting for a solution. We're part of the problem. Let's sort it out ourselves as well.
That ends the period for listed questions, and we now move on to 15 minutes of topical questions. And before I call Mr Joe Byrne, could I inform members that question number 8 has been withdrawn. I call Mr Joe Byrne.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister, in relation to Strabane, which is a campus part of the North West College, what proposals do the Department have to try and meet the accommodation needs there in terms of a new build for the future?
Well, at this stage, there's nothing currently in the pipeline that is being discussed in relation to the situation in Strabane. I mean, we have some potential redevelopment, I think it's in terms of the Springtown campus, in terms of North West College. There's nothing in Strabane that's currently on the radar for the foreseeable future in terms of capital spend.
Thank you. And Mr. Byrne for supplement.
I welcome the answer by the Minister, but however, it raises a further question. Given that Strabane has suffered so much unemployment in the past and we're trying to get some economic development in the area, would you agree that perhaps a business case looking to the future in terms of a new build would be an advisable opportunity for the future?
Yes, in theory. I mean, the provision of an FE campus or a revised FE campus will be an economic economic activity generator. The issue is, however, I mean, how far we can stretch budgets in terms of investments that we are making at present. And there are a host of other projects that are currently things that we are committed to. But I also stress as well that I wouldn't say that the future of Strabane economic depends on an FE college being redeveloped in the town. There are host of other things that we can do, including working with people directly in terms of their skills through existing provision, and also what we can do to attract jobs into the area as well. And I'm certainly happy to play my role in that regard.
Thank you. And I call Mr. John Dallett.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, the Minister, of course, has said in the throes of cutbacks and austerity moves and whatnot. Can I ask the Minister, what steps has he taken to ensure that the most vulnerable young people, who are usually furthest away from the labour market, are protected? And can he tell this House that they will not be affected?
Well, at this stage, I can't give the member a cast-iron guarantee in that regard, nor tell him the full details as to how we're going to try to go about protecting those young people who are most vulnerable. But I can give the member an assurance that there's two guiding principles that I am adopting to how we go about looking at the challenge of the cuts facing us. The first one is to try to prioritise those areas of activity that are most relevant to the economy, and I stress that virtually everything we do is relevant to the economy, but those areas that are most relevant to the economy, and for example, something like the Assured Skills Programme, where we work with directly with investors over putting people straight into jobs, is an example in that regard. And secondly, that we have a commitment to try to protect those young people who are most vulnerable. So I fully understand why that question is being asked. But in terms of the scale of cuts that we are facing, it is next to impossible to give any guarantee that we will have 100% protection for any area of the work of the department.
Dallett for supplementary.
Deputy Speaker, the answer given by the Minister is somewhat disappointing. Since we have made reference to that marginal line called the border, can I ask the Minister what discussions he's had with the Irish Government to ensure that those people on both sides of the border are protected, because they are often the people who are furthest away from the labour market?
First of all, I'm slightly confused as to why the member is a bit disappointed with my answer, because this is where the wheels begin to come off in terms of budgets. Because we've been warning all along that putting all the eggs in the basket of protecting the current welfare budget will have implications elsewhere for how we help those other people who are most vulnerable in society. Because the investment we can make in terms of skills and employability is the means by which we actually give people opportunity to secure a job and to actually move out of welfare situation. And that is the trade-off that we are now making as an Assembly in terms of decisions that certain people have chosen to make. In terms of cooperation and discussions that we have been having with ministers in the Republic of Ireland, well, the answer in that regard is very simple. I want to check from my colleagues in the Republic of Ireland, because we're currently educating about 3,500 people from the Republic of Ireland in FE colleges in Northern Ireland, because there is not an adequate provision, particularly in County Donegal, where at level 2, North West Regional College is becoming the main provider of education and training at that level. This amounts to something like £7 million that's going out of the Northern Ireland Block grant to train students from the Republic of Ireland. I'm more than happy that we see students moving in both directions around the border, where certain courses will be provided on one side of the border, other courses on a different side of the border. That's the natural way that the situation should be. But at present, in terms of further education, it is one-way traffic from the south into the north, particularly in the Donegal to Derry corridor, and that has a massive disproportionate impact upon our budgets. That's a structural problem that we have to resolve on a north-south basis. We're up for doing it, but my colleagues in the Republic of Ireland aren't prepared to face up to this reality at present.
Thank you. And I call Ms Brenda Hale.
Thank you, Mr Principal Deputy Speaker. And can I ask the Minister, can he tell the House how he is supporting women into engineering with regards to sector of attractiveness and retention?
Well, first of all, just to concur that the issue of gender balance in engineering, as well as some other key areas in terms of our economy, is of absolute crucial importance. We have a very heavily skewed workforce at present, and frankly, without a proper equal opportunities approach, where the sector itself and the economy as a whole is going to miss out on a lot of talent that is available to it. We have worked to develop an engineering action plan as part of a wider working group that I've established back in 2012, and the gender considerations are part and parcel of that. The Equality Commission as well have devised with the STEM Business Coordinator a charter of best practice for business, which will also hopefully be effective in terms of attracting women into the sector. But the issue isn't purely about the attraction into the sector, it's also about retention and progression within work as well, and there are barriers in that regard that we also need to turn our mind to.
Sale for supplementary.
I thank the Minister for his answer, and you spoke earlier about how high-level skills actually drive our economy. So would you agree that funding appropriate programmes to deliver and support expansion of the advanced manufacturing and engineering sector will not only send the right message to women but to the industry as a whole?
We're very happy to do promotional work in this area because there's a key, whether it's an equal opportunities rationale or a key economic rationale, there's a strong imperative for us to seek to maximise participation in these areas. And again, I stress that as we look to the areas that are set to grow the most over the coming years, at present they are heavily male-dominated. By contrast, the areas that are under most pressure, most notably the public sector, tend to be disproportionately female. So there's a major structural problem here that's going to only be exacerbated in the coming years unless we take action to correct this and to ensure that we have a strong pipeline with both genders in the key sectors such as engineering.
Thank you. And I call Ms Rosalind McCauley.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answers. And Deglamira and Ira, Gajemar Tase, Cosanchin and Inias Liga, Ogasea Galwu, Dumbusage, Abusage of Lane, Gavilas, Craig Jeg Shejeg. Can I ask the Minister, how is he protecting the most vulnerable people in terms of preparing for his budget for 2015-16?
Well, again, this tends to follow on from the question that was asked by Mr. Dalit, and I would say that I am trying to be as responsible as I can in that regard, and it's one of the key determinants in terms of the decision-making I am making in relation to where cuts are sadly going to have to be made. But in terms of equal opportunities, let me just say the same thing as I said to the SDLP, to the members for Sinn Féin. If we continue with a very single-minded approach around trying to protect the vulnerable through not facing up to difficult decisions around the welfare budget, then there will be simply less money available in terms of helping those who are most vulnerable to get a foot on the ladder, to invest in their skills, their employability skills, and to enable them to find and sustain employment. So choices have to be made in this regard. And there's no point in the member talking about what I'm doing to protect the vulnerable. Whenever the policies that are currently being adopted by default through the blockages from her party are having an adverse effect on our ability to help the most vulnerable.
Ms McCauley for a supplementary.
Well, can I ask the Minister, would he accept that if there were to be reduction in student places or increase in tuition fees, that this would nevertheless impact most greatly on those from disadvantaged backgrounds?
Indeed, that may well may well be the case, and if we end up, for example, with less places locally, that would mean either people are forced to go looking for a place in Great Britain, or by default they have nowhere to go in terms of either higher education or indeed further education. But again, this comes down to the point, I mean, what are we going to do differently to have a sustainable budget settlement? There's no point coming into the chamber and talking about how we're going to carve things up and how am I going to stop something happening that is sadly an inevitable consequence of the budget settlement that pertains in Northern Ireland. Unless we change direction, I mean, we're going to have these circular arguments incessantly for the coming months and years.
Thank you, and I call Ms. Dolores Kelly.
Principal Deputy Speaker, Minister, we will perhaps recall some 18 months ago, Junior Minister Bell announced 100 apprenticeship places under the T-Book paper, which were to be delivered largely by your department. Could you tell us how many of those apprenticeships have been provided?
Well, at this stage, we are waiting to see what money is going to be available for the United Youth programme in the 2015 and 16 budget. We're currently advanced in terms of the co-design process around United Youth, and indeed we have gone out to call for a number of projects in that regard. Now, frankly, whereas I have £1 million in my budget this year to proceed with that programme, until we have some degree of certainty of having any budget in 2015 and 16 to take those forward, it would be irresponsible to press the go button in that regard. So while there's no core funding in my department's budget for United Youth, it would be optimistic that we will be able to secure some funding to enable us to expand this over the coming months.
Bruce Kelly for a supplement.
Thank you. So therefore, Minister, 18 months on, in essence you're telling us that not one apprenticeship place has been provided. And Minister, could you then give a commitment to myself and to this House that you will tell us exactly where, if there are to be any such places, how those resources are going to be targeted right across the North?
Well, again, I say to the member, I'm not sitting here or standing here taking any points around what we're spending or not spending until other parties in this chamber adopt a more responsible approach to this. And there's no point the member heckling from the sidelines saying we're not delivering. Until her party adopts a more responsible attitude towards funding in Northern Ireland, we're going to be going round and round in circles having circular arguments because... This may well be news to the SDLP, but most people in the outside world recognise you cannot deliver if you don't have a budget. It's a simple fact of life.
Paul, Mr. Gregory Camp.
Mr. Speaker, could the Minister update the House on the progress towards the future of the Northern Regional College in Coleraine?
Well, we are awaiting the final receipt of a business case, hopefully in the next few weeks. In relation to the capital investment of Northern Regional College, and as I've made comment on earlier, we have a number of different aspects to that. One would be the redevelopment of a site in Ballymena as a consolidated site, and a redevelopment in the northern part of the jurisdictional area, which may be Coleraine, it may be Ballymoney. I'm not going to say anything further than that in case I upset somebody. And decisions will be taken in that regard. There has been an historic underfunding of capital in the Northern Regional College area compared to some of the other areas in Northern Ireland. So I am happy to give it priority that we will seek to find the money, if and when available, to facilitate those matters proceeding as quickly as possible.
Mr. Campbell for supplementary.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. The Minister will be aware that the premises that the staff there in the Coleraine campus currently operate under they are not good premises. I was in them recently, but will he endeavour to come to that conclusion in order that the staff there can deliver a state-of-the-art service for the entire community in the Causeway Coast?
I'm keen that we make decisions in this regard as quickly as we possibly can. And frankly, this issue has been hanging around for quite some time. I'm not going to stand here and argue about the quality of the accommodation in Coleraine being of sufficient quality. One of the things that we do need to bottom out is just around precisely what's going to be required in terms of curriculum provision, because that is the key to then determining what is the estate that we require in that regard. But the case, I think, for redevelopment is beyond... beyond question. The issue is exactly what we provide, where and how quickly, and that will be determined by money.
And that's the end for questions, and we now move on to the questions to the Minister of Enterprise, Trade and Investment. And could I